Oh, that was so good. So good. Is Dave here? Dave, I just want to tell you what a great job you did. You and Cindy did a great job with the flush toilets. Can you imagine? If you've never been to... I don't know what all the laughter's about. If you've never been to Premier Source, you don't realize the impact of a flushing toilet. But if you've been there, you know what a big deal that is. And we're just excited about it. I'm excited because I'm going in December. Why don't you go with me? And I'm going to use one of them. I'm sure of it. I'm sure of it if I can catch the students in class. Thank you for that and for your trip and for Beth. Those shirts, the kids love them. And man, we're going to celebrate. We have such a great oversight team, wonderful Haiti oversight team. And Beth just made a journey for us. She made a journey to Port-au-Prince, and she has hand-delivered one of our favorite people here today. And his name is Charles Jean Danique. We call him Danny or Danik, and I want to get him up here right now. This is his first time out of Haiti. All right. This is Danik, and you can be Facebook friends with Danik. Charles Jean Danique, D-A-N-I-C. You can be Facebook friends with Danik. Danik is one of our teachers at the school. He teaches computer. But Danny's story is deeper than that, and it's so much more powerful than that. And if you come tonight, you'll hear his story, how he came into our world, into our life. It's an incredible, incredible story, and we're going to share it tonight at the Haiti dinner, 5:30. If you don't want to come and eat, if you want to come and eat, bring something to share. If you don't want to, then come at 6:30, and we're going to be in here. We're going to be sharing about our mission. Many of you sponsor kids or support the mission in some way. And we want to tell you where we're at and what's going on and what's next for our mission there. So this is Danik. He is so talented. He is one of our favorite people, and he can do so much. He learned English so fast. Now, this is his first time in America. We're just walking through an airport with an escalator. One of those moving floors is brand new to him. I remember when I did it with Jameson for the first time. And it's so you can imagine this setting is new for him. It's all a first experience. The food he's going to eat this week, I hope your stomach will take it, my friend. But we're going to introduce you to American food. Do you want to say something, Danik? I'm going to try to lean close so you can get my microphone, but you just speak normal.
Okay. Oh, good morning, everyone. Okay, as Pastor Dave says, my name is Charles Jean Danik. You can call me Danik. I'm from Jeremy, and I work at Gateway Mission School in Jeremy. I have been working there for 6 years and love the children and people I work with. And so I teach computers and working at the director's office. So I'm so happy to be here, and I want to say thank you so much, Beth, to get me at the airport, Port-au-Prince, to come here. So a lot of thanks here supports me. So in America, it's very quiet, no trash in the street. Yeah, I love this country. So I recently got married. We are expecting our first child in this month. Yeah. I'm so excited about that. So, and I will spend like 4 days here and come back to California, San Diego, to meet my wife. And I love you so much, guys. I'm so happy to God to be able to meet all of you guys, and love you so much, guys. Thank you so much.
Hey. Now, Danik met and married an American girl who was working in a mission there in Jeremy. So, we like to say Danik hit the jackpot, you know. Danik did well. And so his wife is back in San Diego because she's due with the baby later this month.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So very exciting. A lot of good things happening in Danik's life. And we don't know if we'll see him come back through, but we'll cover that. But we will see him tonight. Now, someone said you may want to sing a little song. You want to sing, Ouvrez chanter, moi v'lez décider?
Yes, I can do
that. In Creole and in English?
English, Creole.
Okay. You want some help?
Oh, I can.
What about Jim Sung?
Yeah, I can do it. Yeah.
Okay, come on, Sun. You want to help him? You remember Creole? You remember this guy, don't you? No microphone. You, back up. This is Danik's moment. All right. All right. You're going to sing it in English, in Creole and in English.
Okay.
Ready?
To follow Jesus, I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus.
All right. Thank you, Danny. All right. Danny's story is one about following Jesus. He lost his parents when he was a little bitty boy. They died in a shipwreck. Both his parents died when a boat capsized. Too many people on the boat and waves and the shifted load. And so Danny didn't really know his parents, but man, he knows his Lord, and just invited you to know him as well. Thank you, Danik. We look forward to tonight and his great story and how he came into our life. It is a powerful, powerful story. We're going to share it tonight. 6:30 here, 5:30 if you're going to eat. All right, so we're going to receive the offering now, and here's what we're going to do. I'm going to pray. And then students, after the offering passes your row, if you would, you're dismissed to go upstairs after my prayer and after the offering passes your row. So, because you ought to be dropping something in it, right? Oh, wow. Yeah, they should, shouldn't they, if they work. Anyway, let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for your blessing and your grace. We thank you for Danik this morning, what a testimony he has and what a testimony he shares and will continue to share, and what a work you're doing in his life and in the lives of so many kids and people in a little place called Premier Sous. We thank you, God, that you give us the opportunity to be a part of that. Help us to know that every time we give, that we're able to do things like that, not only in Jeremy, Haiti, but here in St. Albans, in Taze Valley, and in West Virginia. And we pray, God, that you would help us become good stewards of what we're giving. As an act of worship, Lord, now we give to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'll be home for Christmas if only in my dream.
All right. So the students are released to go to their class. They're going right upstairs here, and they'll spend about 30 or 40 minutes talking about their lesson. Well, I love that song. Don't you like that song? It's one of my favorites. It's one of the most feel-good songs we could sing at Christmas. And this series that we're going to do over the next several weeks is really a series that rings so true, is that we want to be home for Christmas. Home for Christmas is the theme. We're going to talk about in this series different aspects of being home, why we like to come home, what the value is in coming home, and maybe you're going to travel somewhere for Christmas. Maybe you're going to come home or go home, or maybe people are going to come to your home for Christmas, and it'll make it the best season because of the people that are coming. One 2011 study that interviewed seniors, older folks, asked them, you know, what is it about Christmas and your childhood and your memories? And they related being home for Christmas with their childhood home, with community and their places of worship. Researchers concluded that there were three words that kept reoccurring that defined home for them. And they were the words attached, this is where I feel attached, comfortable, this is where I'm comfortable, and secure or safe. And that's home. You know, that's a place where you kick your shoes off, walk around your sock feet or less if you want. And you can let your hair down and your belly hang out. It's home. It feels good. And we're going to talk about different things related to that. Today we're going to talk about what I think really is the big thing about being home, and that's family. Family is what makes us want to be home for Christmas. That's why it's so hard at Christmas time if you've lost a loved one in your life. It's why it's so hard if you have an empty chair around your table, or maybe you have an empty space in your heart, because that's family. And my experience is whether the loss is recent or if it was 10 years ago or even further back, is still at Christmas time, it is a painful, painful loss. And the reason is because that's family. That's where family sat. That's who we are. And we're gonna talk about some things like that, but I just want to, as a side note here early on in the message, I just want to tell you that at this time of year, people are more depressed and lonely and even suicidal. They're even more suicidal between now and the beginning of spring than at any other time on the calendar, because there's so much surrounding family and these holidays. There was a study on Forbes.com that researched what holidays were the biggest travel holidays. And you guessed it, Christmas. In 2014, 15, and 16, over 99 million people traveled at Christmas. You know what the runner-up was? The runner-up was my favorite holiday, Thanksgiving. And that was over 40 million people traveled at Thanksgiving. So it's no doubt and no wonder that people travel because of family. And that's why people are traveling mostly, to be with family. You can be on vacation, but you want to be home, especially for Christmas. And that bears out in the research. So this is a series that's going to kind of whet your appetite and to remind you of some good things about being home. And one of my favorite memories, and some of my favorite memories, have to do with my grandparents being at their home for Christmas. I can still smell the food that was cooked and the aroma in the room, and I can hear voices from way back, and I loved, you know, the quiet Christmas that my grandfather loved out in his front room, and it was, you know, he liked it just to be very small and very quiet, and wasn't a lot of a fanfare, and that's kind of the man that he was. And there's so many memories, and I bet you have some. What do you think of when you think of home for Christmas? What are those memories that come to your mind from your childhood? What things are you creating? What moments and traditions are you creating in your own family? One of my favorite songs this time of year is called Over the River and Through the Woods. How many of you remember that song? Okay, so I'm gonna do the first part of it, and I want you to finish the second part of this line, okay? Over the river and through the woods. Okay, so I hear you are singing it wrong also. Did you know that? For years I sang this song, Over the River and Through the Woods, to grandmother's house we go. The horse knows the way to carry the sleigh on white and drifted snow. It's not grandmother's house. I looked this up, I researched this, and it's grandfather's house. Yeah, and it's not even Christmas. It's a song about Thanksgiving. Did you know that? Man, we could sing things for years and not know the truth behind it. So it's grandfather's house, and it's about Thanksgiving Day. But hey, mine lived in the same house, my grandfather, as my grandmother. And we did a lot of traveling to their house at Thanksgiving and at Christmas. Traveling is not new to the Christmas story, is it? It's not new to families. If you remember, one of the greatest stories of Christmas is in Matthew. We may have time to look at that in this series, when the wise men or the magi traveled for months and months, maybe even years, to get to the baby. And when they got there, they got to the house. It could have been 2 years after, because Herod had all babies 2 years and under killed, if you remember that story. They traveled a long distance. Traveling wasn't new. The shepherds walked out of the fields to the stable and to the manger scene. Mary and Joseph went up from Galilee to Bethlehem so that the baby could be born. But I think the greatest traveling of all, the biggest journey, the greatest journey covered, the ground covered, was when God came to the earth and became a man. There's so much we could say about that. The Bible says in Philippians chapter 2, an early Christian song, by the way, about Jesus, that he did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. As our worship leader Steve said, God put a suit on. He put his suit on. We like to say God put some skin on. He came down. That was a great big journey that he traveled so that he could be your Savior and mine. Now that passage in Philippians is a great passage for any time of year, for Christmas, for Easter, for lots of the year. But the passage we're going to look at today is what I think is the most popular gospel passage about the Christmas story, and it's in Luke chapter 2. If you have your Bible, if you want to find it on your phone, or you can read it with me on the screen back here. And I would like to stand and read this passage together, because this is such a notable traditional passage. This is from the NIV, and we'll read it together standing. If you can stand, if you can't stand, just stay seated. But read this with me from the screen. Here we go. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. Thank you. You may be seated. What a beautiful image we have here of this family, of this family. For the first time, this family is welcoming a child. We have a husband, we have a wife, we have a dad, a mom, and now we have a baby. And can you imagine the anticipation standing out above the exhaustion, above any pain that there might have been, above any stress and turmoil of the journey and of the pregnancy? Above all of that was the joy of this child, the baby. And I can tell you from firsthand experience that a brand new boy in a family is really going to be fun at Christmas. In fact, I think maybe I've got a picture of him. I just accidentally put one up there. And he's ready for Christmas. And we can't wait to see what he's gonna get into and what we're going to let him get into. Huh? So family is so important. Such a wonderful time. You know, family is important because it's where we really count. It's where we really count. This young man, Augustus, Caesar Augustus was his name. Caesar Augustus wanted to count his people, and for good reason. I don't know if you know much about history, but the Roman Empire was one of the greatest empires in world history. It was big. It was huge. It stretched from England to Africa and from Syria to Spain. One in every four people in the first century were within the confines of the Roman Empire. And when you think about that, that's pretty incredible. In the first century, there were between 4 and 5 million people in the Roman Empire. There were lots of people. I mean, that's not a big number to us today, but it is a big number for first century census and first century population counts. The Roman Empire was huge. And by the way, Caesar Augustus reigned for a total of 40 years. 40 years of peace and prosperity. He issued in a new era, an era into which God saw fit to send his son. It's pretty incredible. We could spend time talking about that, but we'll save that for later. So Joseph, by no choice of his own, by no decision that he made, is a member of the big, multicultural, multi-ethnic, vast Roman Empire. And Caesar Augustus wanted to count him. He wanted to be counted. You see, in those days, they did a census for tax purposes. Usually it was to see who's within the boundaries so we can see how much money we're going to collect. It's a lot the same today. They do a census every, 10 years, I think it is, so that they can decide where, you know, where people are, what the trends are, where money's going, where money should go, and that kind of thing. And this was the same kind of thing. This census was for the purposes that the Roman Empire, the Roman emperor, could say to this vassal king, that would be a king within the greater Roman Empire, who would count his people. So we're gonna count, you're gonna count, and then you're gonna give us your count, and then I'm gonna tell you how much money you're gonna give us based on your count. And so Herod was the vassal king, if you will, over this area, and he had to do a count. And Joseph, by nature of being in that realm, had to be counted. How many of you are from big families? We have anybody here? You know, every now and then I'll run into someone who's from a family of like 10 or 12 kids. And I'm just curious this morning, how many of you are from a family of 5 kids or more? 5 or more. Keep your hand up. 5 or more. All right, we're gonna see who puts your hand down. 5 or more, keep your hand up. 5 or more kids. I'm talking about kids. All right. Now, you count any way you want to. If you want to count step brothers and sisters and half and whole and partially and all those, you can do whatever you want. How many of you are from 6 or more? Keep your hand up. 6 or more? Okay. We still got some hands up. 7. 7. Some hands went down. How about 8? Do I hear 8? Still got one over here. Still 8? 8? 8? Do I hear 8? Do I hear 9? Do I hear 9? Hands still up strong over here. 2 over here for 9. Anybody? We got one there, 9. Anybody here for 9? How about 10? We're going 10. Steve's hand is still up. Anybody? Richard's hand's still up. We lost one here. All right. Did I say 10? Okay, how about 11? How about 11? Good grief, guys. How about 12? 12? 12 in your family, Richard. How about 13? How about 14? How many, Richard? 16 kids. All right, now what we're all wondering, Richard, is this the same mother? Same mother, bless her heart. 16 children. Well, that beats the first service. Wow, that's a big family, isn't it? That's a big family. Whether you're from a big family or small family, it doesn't matter. One guy who was from a big family said his family was big because his mother was hard of hearing. I said, what? He said, yeah. He said, every night my mom and dad would go to bed, my dad would turn the light off and he would say, you want to go to sleep or what? And she would say, what? Now, you might have to think about that one, all right? And you can think about that. So, big families, you know, sometimes they happen, sometimes they don't. Did your mom or dad ever run through the names to get to yours? Did you ever run through the names, like a whole list of them, and you're like, hey, I'm not the firstborn, come on down a little bit. Or maybe she used your full name to count you off, you know, and get down to you. Or maybe you're on vacation or at a restaurant or even leaving church and you're like, okay, how many's in here? Oh, we got all the seats filled. Yeah, the five of us. Let's get out of here. And sometimes she miscounted or they wouldn't get you all. And if you got 16 or 10 in your family, how could they keep up with you? Man, you really had to fight for it, didn't you, Richard? Just had to show up, didn't you? And I bet there's no dinner table that big. You know, you got to be there early. I bet you didn't have trouble getting the dinner on early, you know, on time and early. So, being counted is nothing new. How many of you are counters, by the way? Anybody counters? You count things. You just count things. You know, I have to confess, I'm a counter. Every time I go up to see our chickens, I count them. I'm like, I got to get the 20, you know, I got to get the 20. Every time I get up there, I got to get the 20. And I count things, like maybe the lights here or, you know, trees or something. Some of you are counters. And when I say that family is where you count, you really count, hopefully you know what I'm talking about is that family is not just where you really count, but it's where you're counted on. You're counted on. When God put man on the earth, he looked down at him after running the animals by him, and Adam no doubt was counting the animals and naming the animals, and God said, look at man. There is no, of all the creation, there is no suitable helper. There's no one like him who can walk beside him. So the Bible says that God put man to sleep and he took part of his side. We often translate that as rib, but it was really a part of the side. And there's an interesting study in that whole thing about how God made a woman to mirror man. I mean, there's a lot, you know, we look the same. We're humans. Our noses are in the same place. Can you imagine if your wife's nose was in a different place than yours? And there's a lot of reasons why we look alike and why, you know, why man was made for woman and woman was made for man. I mean, I don't want to get into a hot button issues here today, but there's a reason why man and woman were made for each other. God did that so man could start counting. One plus one, God would say, equals one. One. That was a good try. One plus one equals one. How does that happen? The Bible says the two become one. Two become one. And after the fall of man, eventually they started counting again. They started counting kids. They had Cain and Abel. Then Seth came along. And then there was a whole slew of kids. We just call them a whole slew, like a family of 16. There's just a whole slew of them. There's a bunch of them. I can't even count them anymore. And you and I are part of that number. And so God counts. Everybody counts. And everybody is counted on. Listen, God made you men. He made you to be counted on. He made you to toe the line, not to sit in the back, not to lay down, not to stand idly by while Satan destroys your family. God made you to toe the line and to count. And you're counted on. Your wife needs you. She needs you in this life. Ladies, your husband needs you. Your children need you. Now, if you're here today and you're single, or maybe you're single again, I don't know everything to say to you, but I know that you need community. You need others. We need each other. That's why church family is so important, especially if you're single, especially if you're divorced. We need each other. The Bible has so many one another's that we just know that we need one another. We're counted here. We count here. We're counted on. Also, family is that place where we really belong. Now, Joseph was in the greater Roman family. He was within the confines of that great Roman Empire. But the Bible reminds us that although he was there and he was going to be counted as a result of one man in Rome saying, "I want to count," the Bible says he belonged to the house and line of David. You know how it is. You might be a citizen of the world or a citizen of the country, but there's a place where you belong. There's your people. They talk like you, and they say the same things, and they use the same terminology for things. And if you talk to me long enough, I might be able to tell you where your people are from, and so can others. You can do that too. Are you from McDowell County? Or Pikeville, or somewhere down in Georgia, or are you from West Virginia? You know, we can pretty much find out where we belong, can't we? I used to hate to go out of the state when I was a younger man. People would say, "Look down at my feet," first of all. And I don't even have to tell you why, do I? And make a joke, and then they would say, "You been in the coal mines?" Like, man, I grew up in a part of West Virginia. I never even saw a coal mine. I don't even know what you're talking about. Never even seen one, until I was a grown man. Older did I ever see a coal mine. Now, that's not to say anything bad about coal mines, but we're all different here in West Virginia. There's places where we belong. We belong in a certain place. And when it came to Joseph, he belonged to a certain family. It wasn't just the greater Jewish family or the Roman family. He belonged to the house and line of David. Now, one of the questions surrounding the nativity story is, why are there two different genealogies, one in Matthew and one in Luke? Well, the quick answer is that Luke traces Mary's genealogy and Matthew traces Joseph's genealogy. And they both go all the way up to David. And what the Bible's trying to say, what the gospel writers are trying to say, is that this Jesus is fulfilling the prophecy of coming in the line of David from both sides of the family. He's coming from both sides of the family. The Bible says in Isaiah, a popular Christmas passage, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end." And here's where we get David's connection. "He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever." And there are many more passages of Scripture that tie Jesus to David. And so when Mary and Joseph come along, the gospel writers made sure to let people know Jesus is in the line of David because both his mother and his father were in that line. It's nice to belong, isn't it? You know, belonging, a sense of belonging, is one of your greatest needs. It's one of our greatest human needs, right up there with food and water and shelter. You know, my wife and I have been in the, we've taken a young lady out of the foster care system, and of course we have adopted our Haitian son. And let me tell you something from our experience, and maybe you experience this too, maybe you don't even realize it, but this need to belong somewhere is so great. I mean, can you imagine growing up and never feeling like I belong here? Where's my next home going to be? Where's my next set of parents going to be? And just going from home to home to from place to place. And so what we do, what we can do as families is make sure we say to our children, and we don't even have to say this to biological children, but we have to say this to children, this is your last stop. This is where you belong. This is your family. And we don't even understand, those of us who grow up with our biological families, we don't understand what that lack of sense of belonging does to our psyche, to our personality, to how we act and how we react to everything in our life. A sense of belonging is so important. It's so important. We need it. That's why it feels so good to come home for Christmas, to have traditions that go year after year after year. But there's one other aspect I want to talk about real quickly, and that is that family's not always a perfect place, is it? As I was reading the story again for the umpteenth time, something jumped out at me as I was reading this. I love verse 7. It's kind of the premier verse when it comes to the nativity and our Christmas stories and the pictures we paint and the scenes we create. Verse 7 says, she wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. Because if you're like me, you grew up on the King James Version, and that term guest room is accurate. It's accurate. But we like it from the King James. It says, she brought forth her firstborn son, and she wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and she laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Now we can picture this scene, can't we? It's a great nativity scene. You see Mary and Joseph and maybe some shepherds and some sheep, and maybe a cow or a goat or a camel or something. What a beautiful scene. The starlight coming through the back window that the wise men were following. It's a beautiful scene. And we don't really linger on this too much, but I've got a question. If this were the home of Joseph, why were they in a stable? Matthew chapter 5 indicates that Jesus would come from Bethlehem, the Messiah, but it never says anything about him being born in a stable or laid in a manger or put down where animals trod. Doesn't say that. We know that happened, but it doesn't say that that was the prophecy. And what I want to know is why. Didn't the King of the universe, the Prince of Peace, the Mighty Counselor, and all that, didn't he deserve the best palace that earth could offer? Sure he did. But the child of Christmas got the lowliest place. He got the lowliest place. I mean, there was stuff there that probably didn't smell very good. You know what I'm saying? If Bethlehem was the town of Joseph's family, why wasn't he knocking on the door of some relatives? Surely there was an empty couch somewhere, or a floor. Opie Taylor used to say, if we have company, I get to sleep on the ironing board. And that's adventure sleeping. And you know, you always make room for family, don't you? You always do. I mean, we might be full, but if you're family, man, there's a spot for you. What happened here? Why didn't Joseph go to family? Didn't his own family have room for him? John's gospel kind of echoes this sentiment. When it says, the true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world, he was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Now, there might be a lot of spiritual and theological reasons why Jesus came and was born and laid in a manger. God's greatness reaching man's insignificance. God's righteousness bridging the gap between he and man's brokenness. God becomes approachable and accessible and available to man by coming to the lowliest of places. But what if it was all that, but it was something else too? What if it was an indication that Joseph's family just screwed up? They just messed up. And that they failed to make room for him. Isn't that the gospel? Is that God's people said, we know you. We don't know you. We know you. We don't know you. You're not welcome here. And so he went to a cross. You see, this is an indication, I think, another place where the Bible, the story is trying to say, look, families aren't perfect. They're not perfect. Sometimes dads say things they shouldn't say or do things they shouldn't do. And moms act in a way they shouldn't act. And kids, we know they're sinners. Yeah. So we all have to say, you know, I'm sorry. Please forgive me. I love you. We're family. We're family. And we want to be together. And you know what? This reminds me, even though family is not always a perfect place, it reminds us that we need Jesus. He makes it perfect. He makes it better. That's why we love Christmas. Because this story makes our story the perfect story. We needed him so much. You need him today. If you're here today and you don't know him, I just want to say, if you want to celebrate Christmas unlike any other time, get to know him. And you'll be able to celebrate Christmas better than you ever have before. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this message. Thank you so much for your word. Thank you for the story. Incredible story within a story. Just simply about you coming to the earth and how we accept you or reject you. Lord, we love our family. I pray that Jesus would be a part of every one of our families to make it complete. That's my prayer in his name. Amen. If you're here today and you're not a Christian, you never welcomed him into your family, I invite you to come. I invite you to come and say, Lord, I want you to be a part of my family. If you never obeyed him in baptism, let's do that. If you never put roots down, let's do that. Stand up. Let's sing. And if you want to come and talk to me about a decision you have today, come as we sing.